speak to men and women, saints.
I blesses our family, O Lord, and blesses us through the body of Jesus. Pray for us, most holy Mother of God. Let's pray. Pour forth and beseech thee, O Lord, thy grace to fill our hearts, that we may through the incarnation of Christ thy Son, as may know the blessed of an angel, and by his passion. Follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord. able to discern reflections and thoughts of the heart.
Alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus told his disciples this parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out at dawn to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with them for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. Going out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the fields. He said to them, "You too go into my vineyard, and I will give you what is just." So they went off, and he went out again around noon, and around 3 o'clock, he did likewise. Going out about 5 o'clock, he found others standing around and said to them, "Why do you stand here idle all day?" They answered, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You too go into my vineyard." When it was evening, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, "Summon the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and ending with the first." When those who had started about 5 o'clock came, each received the usual daily wage. So when the first came, they thought that they would receive more. But each of them also got the usual wage. And on receiving it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last ones worked only an hour, and you have made them equal to us, who bore the day's burden and the heat." He said to them in reply, "My friend, I am not cheating you. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what is yours and go. What if I wish to do this last one the same as you? Or am I not free to do as I wish with my own money? Are you envious because I am generous?" Thus the last will be first, and the first will be last. The Gospel of the Lord. The whole point of a parable, the whole methodology of the Lord's parables, is that they start with a familiar image, something that ought to be fairly self-explanatory. Even if you've never worked in a field, you can imagine what it would look like. Going out in the morning hoping that some landowner is going to pick your team to do the job, and going out there and sweating for the heat of the day. I think we can imagine the scene readily enough. Even us city boys can imagine the scene readily enough. But the whole point of a parable, too, is that it's meant to throw us off our guard. It's meant to arrest us from the conception of the way things go. And so it is here that the landowner opts to pay them equally. He opts to pay them the day's wage. As the Lord would say elsewhere, sufficient for the day is its own evil. That's enough to be able to get through the day. And the minute that you're beginning to look and compare at how other people are doing, provided each gets enough for his necessity, what are you exactly grumbling about? Now, this image is a bit of an odd one. I think in our day, if someone did this, you'd be brought before a state employment office or something else and brought up on a charge of this or that. And maybe to a point that would be fair, economically. But the Lord brings up this image, this strange image, because he's talking about how salvation works. How everyone who has been called proceeds in turn, and that Christ is the first fruits of the resurrection, that all who follow him will be called each in proper order. The Blessed Mother, whose assumption we celebrated last week, being the first and preeminent example of discipleship. But then each of us following in turn, and living out this life in union with God, such as we can strive to do through the sacraments, through faith, through repentance, through conversion. But living out our life here in hopes of coming to the full measure of Christ, whether we work for 8 hours or 2, or 15 minutes, like the last laborers. But our sense of the Christian life cannot be one that simply reduces it to a work day, that reduces it to something we do. The initiative remains on God's part. And that is why he is generous with those who come at the end of the day. Because ultimately, the task of our sanctification begins and ends with him. And our working out of that in fear and in trembling is our cooperation in that life of grace, something that can be done over an 8-hour work day or 80 years of life. But the life of grace is worth that consideration, that concern, that work, even if it is open to far more than perceive or receive it in its full scope at the beginning. And so we have to live praying, as this is everything dependent on us working, this is everything dependent on God. And by extension, taking this Christian life spirit seriously, but not just standing and looking down on people whom you might judge to be some way. For it may well come out that they were actually further along than we ever were, and they were working in other parts of the vineyard that we never saw. Meanwhile, we were dawdling and judging them in the heat of the day. The same issue goes against the shepherds of Israel. A shepherd has the right to be fed by his flock. That's why he's working. But woe to those shepherds who displace pasturing the flock with pasturing themselves, taking the initiative that God has made them and commissioned them to show, and applying that initiative to their own self-interest. It's a very tempting arrangement. And if you've ever wondered why priests don't preach about this or that or what happened, often enough, it's out of that self-interest. And so, this passage is a welcome rebuke to any laborer, to any preacher, that it's his job to labor through the full measure of the day and present to you the full measure and full pay that the Christian life entitles you. Pray, brethren, that thy sacrifice of your gifts may be acceptable to God, the Almighty God.
May the Lord hear our prayers and our thanks. Praise the Lord, and our Lord, and our Lord.
Receive, O Lord, we pray, the offerings placed under your altar in commemoration of blessed John Hughes, so that as you brought him to glory, you may, through these sacred mysteries, grant to us your pardon, through Christ our Lord. In a similar way, blood of the Lamb, which will be poured out for you and for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in memory. The mystery of faith. We proclaim the
death of the Lord and the confession of his resurrection until you come.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the sacred passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Lord, we pray upon the illumination of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will reconcile us to yourself, and that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, filled with the Holy Spirit, may become one body and spirit within us. May he make of us an eternal offering of you, so that we may obtain an inheritance of your life, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the blessed Joseph, his spouse, the blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with our Holy Father, St. John, and St. John Hughes, and with all the saints of his constant intercession in your presence through the life of our family. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of the world. Please confirm in faith and charity your Holy Church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Leonard, our bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people who redeemed for your honor. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you, and your compassionate and merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you in their passing from this life, give kindly minutes to your people. We hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom we still all for all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by the light of King and Mary to say,
our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Lamb of God. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Thank you. I say to you, he will put that servant in charge of all his property. Let us pray. In partaking of the heavenly table, Almighty God, confirm and increase strength from our mind, and all who celebrate the feast day of Blessed John the Baptist, that we may preserve the integrity of the faith and walk in the path of salvation we trace for us. In Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Just a brief request that any who are not involved in the rest of the program to please stay behind and help us sanitize the church after Mass. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace.
And thanks
be
to God.
St. Michael, the Archangel, defend us from God. Be our protection against the wickedness of sin and death.
May God be with you.
Oh, I got it.
No, I wasn't going to touch it.